Hello and welcome to NewsClick. Today we have with us economist and professor Venkatesh Athreya. And hello sir, welcome. And so on 18th of December, Prime Minister Narendra Modi announced that 99% of items will attract GST of at 18%
or less.
And only around 1% of items which belong to the category of luxury items would attract the highest rate of 28%. So what is your reaction to it, sir? And what does this mean? What are the implications of this?
Well, you know, we partly seem to be in election mode following the recent results or even prior to that, I wouldn't know, because there have been some rejigging of GST rates over the last several months. And this one seems to suggest that manufacturing industry, for example, would be pleased to have some items moved from the 28% list to the 18% list. But there are implications. If you do this, then what happens to revenues to the government from GST? They may take a hit. Already we are having less than expected GST revenues over this fiscal. And this may raise concerns about the overall deficit. So it seems that you can understand this move only as an election eve move, while also possibly it is the case that the government has in mind raising resources from other sources to manage the deficit, one of which would be, of course, taking on, getting a part of the reserves from the RBI, which they have now denied they're going to do. The other could be that an increase in disinvestment, neither of which is a particularly appropriate way of dealing with the issue. So I can only see it as a political announcement. And it doesn't really address the heart of the issues in GST that have been proved so difficult for especially the small informal sector.
And as we've seen, ever since GST has come into place, there have been constant, consistent protests by traders, small traders, by various segments. I mean, before the Gujarat elections,
they made some concessions.
They made some concessions. And so what is the heart of the issue? Like, what is the problem with GST, to put it simply?
First of all, the GST is an indirect tax, right? Everybody knows it. It's an indirect tax. So the implication of that is that it hurts the poor far more than it hurts the rich, because all those who are required to pay taxes on these items pay at the same rate, regardless of their levels of income or wealth. So, as a share of the poor man's budget, this makes a much bigger impact than as a share of the rich man's budget, for whom it will be a flea bite. So, fundamentally, it's a very regressive mode of taxation, but one that many countries do adopt. In the run-up to the GST, it was claimed that we'll have, you know, once the GST comes in, we'll have one country, one tax. And it was even, you know, astoundingly, it was even claimed as a second liberation, and June 30th of that year was highlighted, saying that a new India is born. I mean, this is absurd that a new India is born when the tax regime for the indirect taxes changes. Leaving aside such, unnecessary hype and unwarranted hype, it has turned out that this is not by any means one country, one tax regime. There is multiple taxation rates, and there are also significant exclusions from the GST net. All this is familiar, but the two main implications of GST are the following. One, that it is a serious erosion of the taxation powers of the states. I mean, they may get a one-time benefit because they do now get to tax services. They get a share of the service sector taxation. But otherwise, the states were essentially surrendering their powers of taxation, where they could have used differential rates of tax across commodities to serve whatever specific ends they had in mind for the state. That is gone. Even a country like the US does not impose this degree of centralization on the goods and services taxes regimes. But we have done that. And it's, I think, in my view, this is a serious erosion of the state's autonomy and revenue-raising powers in attending to their concerns at the state level. So, no wonder they protested for a long time, but ultimately they were forced to kind of fall in line. The second and perhaps very important aspect is the fact that being an indirect tax, what it has done is to expand the tax net at the lower end. Earlier, excise duty would be imposed only on those enterprises with an annual turnover of 1.5 crores or higher. But the GST applies across the board to all units with an annual turnover exceeding 20 lakh rupees. Now, of course, they have a composite scheme which is slightly higher and all that, but nonetheless, this implies that the whole idea of garnering revenue is to garner revenue from the small players, the informal sector. In a sense, GST compounds the anti-small sector effect that demonetization has already unleashed. So this regime over the last 5 years seems to be repeatedly attacking the small and informal sector, despite the perception that earlier this was the regime that would be pro-trader. But in practice, it has turned out to be very, very poor for the informal sector. And apart from, of course, the informal sector enterprises, the workers in that sector have been badly affected. The overall economy has been affected by demonetization. All this is well documented. There's no surprise that protests were there across the country, because, you know, in many of these cases where suppose an enterprise takes works, job works, and the incoming job work will have a certain value, they'll add some value and then sell it. Very often they won't be able to get the appropriate receipts for them to claim tax refunds. So it'll be very difficult for them to run these enterprises once they pay these kinds of input taxes, and they're not able to claim it from the authorities subsequently. And that would be very difficult. The procedures there are quite complicated for the small guys. And that's why many of them have protested. Of course, the government keeps talking about the increase in the number of registered taxpayers and so on. But you're trying to raise resources from the weakest segments of the population, not from the ones who can afford to pay those taxes.
While corporates are granted massive tax
ideally, you should be focusing on raising direct taxes in this country and from the well-to-do. But you have abolished wealth tax a couple of years ago, and your last year, in the last year's budget, the finance minister reduced the tax rate for corporate entities with an annual turnover of less than 250 crores from 30% to 25%. So you are being regressive both in your direct taxation measures and in your imposition of additional indirect taxation. Therefore, you know, I'm not surprised at the protests all over the country, and it was done in such haste. So that they themselves have subsequently modified these rates several times over, indicating the utter lack of preparedness in the run-up to the GST. And this whole hothouse way of going about it, to just get some political brownie points, the whole farce of the June 30th midnight celebration in the Parliament House and all that, I think to me this represents unseemly haste. There have been much more careful balancing should have gone into the... Of course, we hear this now from former advisors who are not so keen to talk when they were in office. But there is a general consensus that demonetization was a disaster and GST was very hastily introduced without adequate preparation. Of course, so was demonetization with the 2000 rupee note. I don't need to remind you of that. So essentially what we have is a regime that seems to essentially look at perception rather than the actual effect of what they do. And this is again a perception phenomenon. Except I think that this is going to have serious implications, because if they actually do not, already they're receiving, as I said, GST revenues well below the expected levels. So they might actually end up with a larger deficit, and they might then try to counter that, to tackle that by more disinvestment, which is quite disastrous. I mean, in fact, I remember that in the previous year's budget, the 75,000 crore target for disinvestment was exceeded by 100,000 crores. They went to 100,000 crores. And so the finance minister claimed that as an achievement. Now, it's not clear to me why disinvestment of public sector enterprises is an achievement. You know, essentially, you are foregoing future revenue for immediate return.
You're selling off capital.
Yes, and there is really no logic to that. I mean, especially if it is purely as a gap filling measure. I mean, one would have to argue much more carefully for justifying disinvestment. I don't think it can be justified, because, I mean, if a private buyer buys a share, obviously he or she expects to make money from it, so wouldn't the government be able to do it? Unless there are legitimate reasons for the government not to make such profits, for social reasons, because public sector enterprises obviously are not driven only by profitability considerations. They have to look at social objectives also under the mandate that they have. So anyway, I think this particular announcement by the Prime Minister, it remains an announcement, by the way, it's still what he says is his wish. to an audience that would like to hear it. And whether the GST Council is able to do this in the current context, whether the states are willing to accept the implied decline in revenues, would have to be seen. But in principle, when you move a number of items on 28% list, one would have to carefully examine if they are really non-luxury items, or is this being a ruse for lowering taxes even on luxury items. We have to see. Only when we look at the actual details, we will have some assessment. But that's a very narrow question. The larger question is, why don't we relook at the whole GST regime itself and you know, redress the problems that the small players are facing, as well as address the question of the states, fiscal powers of the states, which need to be in some sense rebalanced in a situation where they have really lost a lot of the power to tax. And if you're already you know, shouts being heard that, you know, we must bring in petrol, diesel and all that in the GST regime. You know, every time the center makes major concessions in corporate taxation, the revenue losses are taken also by the states. They and this is a decision they don't make, made by the center. So our tax regime, our entire framework of center-state financial relations needs to be revisited. Unfortunately, the 15th Finance Commission has a set of terms of reference which go in the opposite direction of more centralization. But that is a separate matter. We must discuss it some other time. But I think, on the whole, I'm not very impressed with this announcement, which seems primarily an election eve announcement. May not have large revenue implications at one level, but certainly are intended to have a perception effect that, okay, we are, you know, responding to the concerns of the people. Here, of course, primarily certain manufacturers, cement, for example, automakers, some digital cameras. These are all areas where there might be a case for lowering it from 28 to 18%. And that's probably what the Prime Minister is trying to reach out to, those segments. And you know, obviously, there are larger implications here of the political economy of elections and how they run in this country, how they are funded, the whole. And I won't get into all that. But yes, so on the whole, I don't think this is a well-thought-out initiative. We'll have to see. We'll have to see the details of it when it comes to the GST Council. So I think we should leave it at that.
Since GST is applied at two categories of goods, so 18% lowering certain items from 28% to
18% is still a lot. There are about 1,000 and odd classifications. So there is a 0 rate, 5%, 12%, 18%. Back in July of this year, they did a big rejigging. And in that, one of the good things they did was to remove the GST on napkins, sanitary napkins. In fact, we were all shocked when they had put it in a higher tax bracket, and many people have protested. You know, you talk about Beti Bachao and all that, and you end up putting sanitary napkins in an 18% bracket. So it's good that they did some of those things, and some of them they moved to from 28 to 18. As I said, these are all rejiggings after a very hasty, very ill-planned introduction of a tax regime, which is certainly not one country, one tax, but multiple tax rates, with no proper rationale for the various tax rates, and a constant change, rejigging of these rates creates a lot of uncertainty for businesses. So on the one hand, you talk about a stable tax regime. On the other hand, you keep making these changes because you've done the whole thing post-haste. You've not done it with proper planning and thinking. So that you know, I think this government has repeatedly done that.
Just like everything else, it has done in a hasty.
Demonetization or this or the abrupt abolition of the Planning Commission by just an office order and replacement by this Niti Aayog or whatever. So, you know, that's, it's on, you know, it's par for the course, one wanted to say. So,
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
And keep watching NewsClick.